joy giver. And that's why we're here today. We find our joy in the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, one person has found their joy in the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're about to be baptized. Let's turn our attention to the baptistry.
Good morning. This is Kate Wickham. You know Kate because she greets you most Sundays at the door. Well, she's a Christ follower, and she's letting us know that by following Jesus in believers' baptism today. Kate, who is Jesus to you?
He is my Lord.
Kate, on your profession of faith in Jesus, it's with great joy I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Lord, we've done as you've commanded us, and still there is room.
Would you stand and let's sing together? Let's worship.
Come now, Fountain.
Around you this morning, a wave, a happy welcome to worship to everybody around you. Would you do that? I see some folks back there that haven't been waved to. There we go. Great. Perfect. Here we go.
The stars and
Thank you so much. Please be seated.
Good morning. We're the Langleys, Reese, Carrie, and our son, Sam. Carrie and I both grew up in Alabama and first met in high school. After we were married, a job opportunity brought us to the Washington area 20 years ago. Soon after moving here, we joined First Baptist and began attending Fun Young Couples Sunday School class, where we met a number of other couples, many of which we remain lifelong friends with.
It was during this time that we had been praying for years to have children. And so the Lord led us to Ukraine to adopt. We were there 6 weeks, and during that time we faced several challenges. But through it all, the church was there to encourage us, and Pastor Don even prayed for us specifically one Sunday morning. And so when we felt hopeless, God was faithful, and when Samuel was placed in my lap, we knew this was from him. So when we arrived home at the airport, we were greeted by family, friends, also Pastor Kim with a children's Bible, and even probably an enrollment form to get Samuel plugged in right away to the children's activities. The first Wednesday night, I took Samuel to show him off in choir, and Roger in the choir sang to him to welcome him home. These are memories I treasure. And now that we are in the sweet years of raising a teen, we're thankful for the youth ministry and Michael and Shanika, who work very hard to keep our youth together, connected, keep them in the Word, and help them grow in their walk with the Lord. A couple of years ago, we were faced with a scare when I was diagnosed with breast cancer. And again, our church family was right there with us. A close friend who had walked that same journey years before was there to encourage and provide counsel. And through my 5 surgeries, chemo, radiation, the church was there to shower us with meals, prayers, visits, cards, and we were very thankful. So over these 20 years, we have truly experienced what it means to have a church family as precious as First Baptist, and we're blessed to be part of this church.
So whether you are online or in person, it is our joy to welcome you to worship.
Well, thank you, the Langley family, for the welcome this morning. They found out through their life that Jesus Christ, our God, is a rock that they can shelter behind. He's our shield and our fortress. Let's go to him in prayer right now, would you? Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with joy in our hearts, but some with sadness and apprehension for the various circumstances that they face. God, would you bless us, that you would be our focus, that our eyes would always be fixed on you, for you have shown us throughout the ages that you are a shelter in the time of storm, that you are worthy to be praised. We can count on you because you are always faithful. May you always be the King of our hearts. In Christ's name, amen. Would you stand as we continue to worship?
It's all about you. And I will fight when I cannot feel. And I will trust when you don't seem real. I will tell when I cannot speak. And I will step where I can't see. Trusting that this closet's where you are. Na 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 na. It's all about you.
Great job. Having the young people given us great worship leadership today. Such a talented group. We're so blessed to have them. And they're blessed to be a part of a church like this where they have opportunities. The Langleys mentioned Pastor Kim and Michael and Shanika, but Pastor Kim in particular as having an influence on their lives in the raising of their son. Do you realize this weekend Kim celebrates 15 years on our staff as children's pastor? There she is right over there. Kim, if these were normal times, we'd have a big party and reception. We can't do that right now, but we are so thankful that God brought you our way, and you were on the staff doing other things before then, but you became children's pastor 15 years ago, and we have been so blessed. I invite you to take your Bibles and turn to the book of Proverbs. Words aren't going to be on the screen today, so if you have a Bible or have got one on your phone, look this up, Proverbs chapter 5. I'm doing a series of talks these days on reality, and I'm using reality television programs that people, not you, but other people are watching, and I'm not preaching on the program, I'm just using the title to then get into the Word of God and make a point. But last week we talked about this old house. We'll still talk about cops and hoarders and the bachelor and the bachelorette. And finally, keeping up with the Kardashians. You'll want to be here to be a part of that one. But today we're talking about Temptation Island. This program began in 2001. It was filmed on an island off Belize. It was very popular for the first season, but after two seasons, it kind of died out and was canceled. In 2019, it came back with the same host, Mark Wahlberg, and the same basic idea. They take four couples who are in a committed relationship, probably not marriage, but some kind of relationship, but they've hit a rocky patch, and they take them off to this beautiful island and separate them and surround them by beautiful young adults of the opposite sex. And the test is going to be, will they stay faithful and true to their partner, or will they succumb to temptation? And they've had varying results with that. Imagine how foolish it is to tempt fire like that, to play around with temptation that can be so destructive. Proverbs chapter 6, if you want to just turn a page over, chapter 6, verse 27 says, "Can a man scoop fire into his lap without his clothes being burned? Can a man walk on hot coals without his feet being scorched?" You're playing around with fire when you're playing with temptation. You know, I've been at this a long time, and I grew up in a wonderful church like this that gave me lots of opportunities. And when I was just 15, hearing God's call to ministry and wanting to prepare myself, they wouldn't give me the pulpit yet, but they gave me the oldest ladies' Sunday school class to be guest teacher. And they gave me a quarterly of lessons, but I threw that away. I was going to preach. And I went in there, it was about 15 ladies, and I, no matter what the lesson was on that day, I would preach on things like drug addiction, and I talked a lot about sexual temptation and promiscuity, and I could see their heads just kind of going back and their eyes opening wide. They weren't thinking about any of that until I went in there with my lessons. They're all in heaven now. And I've been at this a long time now, and some gray hair, I think, gives me more gravitas and more of a right to talk about this subject than I had as a 15-year-old who really didn't know very much about the subject. This morning, I want to talk to married people and single people about staying sexually pure, faithful before marriage, and faithful to your partner after marriage. Oscar Wilde, the Irish playwright, said, "I can resist anything except temptation." And I think we all have trouble with that. How do we escape temptation? Look at Proverbs 5, our text today. A father is addressing his son. So it's written from a male's point of view, but the lesson is for everybody. Chapter 5, verse 1. "My son, pay attention to my wisdom. Turn your ear to my words of insight, that you may maintain discretion and your lips may preserve knowledge. For the lips of an adulterous woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, she is bitter as gall, sharp as a double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lead straight to the grave. She gives no thought to the way of life. Her paths wander aimlessly, but she does not know it. Now then, my sons," more than one, "listen to me. Do not turn aside from what I say. Keep to a path far from her. Do not go near to the door of her house, lest you lose your honor to others and your dignity to one who is cruel, lest strangers feast on your wealth and your toil enrich the house of another. At the end of your life, you will groan when your flesh and body are spent. You will say, 'How I hated discipline, how my heart spurned correction. I would not obey my teachers or turn my ear to my instructors, and I was soon in serious trouble in the assembly of God's people.' Drink water from your own cistern, running water from your own well." And he goes on, and you can read it on your own, and it's all very valuable material. Paul put it this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18. Flee, run from fornication, sexual sin. Run from it. Keep on running from it. So the question that the TV show is trying to answer, can we resist temptation or will we be attracted to somebody else? Now I say it's a silly theme. The answer is yes, we can be attracted to other people. It's a given. It's entirely natural. It's going to happen in life that we're going to be attracted to people other than the one to whom we're committed. We're going to be tempted all of our lives. Falling in love, being attracted to somebody, is a chemical reaction. We know this now. A chemical reaction that takes place in the brain. It's the highest high known to man. When you fall in love, you do feel different and you feel wonderful and you want that to continue. And so at almost any cost, we pursue it. The reality, though, is that that chemical reaction wears off. It changes. Its lifespan is about 2 years. So you're married to somebody. You're married because she turned you on. You married her because you were attracted to her. But after a couple of years, those feelings have died down. That old magic isn't there. With raising children and paying bills and going to work and taking care of the yard and all of that, who has time? And so the feelings subside. And you think, well, I must not love her anymore. Maybe I married the wrong person. I'm not attracted to him. I'm attracted to him. People break up their marriages, chasing a drug. And sometimes they ruin their whole lives. They throw everything away, only to find out in a couple of years it's the same old story. You don't build your marriage on feelings of love, as important as they are. You build your marriage on commitment. You made a promise. And so you honor your promise. I tell couples, when you're thinking about getting married, the most important question, can I trust him? Does she keep her promises? Because if she doesn't keep her promises in little things, how do you know she'll keep her promise in the big thing? Honor your commitment. And here's the beautiful thing. Yeah, the feelings die down. The passion subsides. But you stay in the relationship and you keep taking care of the house and the bills and you work on your friendship. You do things fun together and then those feelings come back. So you've been married 50 years, that magic is still there. But can you be tempted and attracted to somebody else? Absolutely. That being true, our challenge is to avoid temptation. Don't go near Temptation Island. And the writer of Proverbs 5 is going to help us by reminding us of the cost. So what happens? It's just a momentary thing. It's just a fling. Nobody's going to know. Chapter 5, verse 4. But in the end, she is bitter as gall, as sharp as a double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lead straight to the grave. Verse 9, you lose your honor to others and your dignity to one who is cruel. Strangers feast on your wealth and your toil enriches the house of another. What happens when you give in to that temptation? Now, sin is sin, but there's some things that have more dire consequences, and this is one of them. Because you can lose your reputation, you can lose your Christian testimony, and I'm talking primarily to Christian people today. You love Jesus and you want to be a witness, but you throw it all away. Your life has problem after problem. You lose your honor. Bitterness and disappointment come your way. It's a cruelty. Count the cost. The momentary pleasure is here and then gone, but the consequence, and God can forgive you. Don't miss that. God forgives our sin, but some things can't be returned to you, like that reputation like that testimony. So count the cost. And then keep running. Keep running. That's what Paul says. Keep on running from temptation. He says, stay away from her house. Don't go near the door. Frederick Buechner says, if you want to know who you are, watch your feet, because where your feet take you, that is who you are. So stay away from her. Stay away from her door. You might need to stay away from folks who will take you to her door, who don't have the same Christian convictions you do, who will help the devil talk you into something that is so wrong. Now, if you keep running, there's hope, there's help. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, there's no temptation that's taken you, but such as is common to man. Everybody goes through this, but God is faithful, and he will not allow you to be tempted above which you're able to bear, but with the temptation will make a way to escape. So if you end up on Temptation Island, look for a bridge. Look for a way to get off that island and get to safety. Again, in chapter 5 of Proverbs, remember, it's written from a man's point of view. It's a man talking to another growing up man. But make no mistake, men are guilty too. I think of that guy down in Georgia that shot up those massage parlors because he was tempted. And he killed several innocent people because of the demons he was battling. It wasn't their fault, it was his fault. You're responsible for your actions, not how somebody dresses or how seductively somebody talks. You're responsible for your actions. And adultery and fornication will never be right. Keep on running. This requires discipline, and he warns his son. Now, you don't want to come to the end of your life with your flesh and body spent, and you say, oh, I hated discipline. I wouldn't listen to my teachers. I wouldn't listen to my parents. It takes a disciplined life. So watch how you spend your time. Watch how you spend your time. How you spend your days is how you spend your life. Be careful with idle thoughts. What you fill your brain with, what you look at, what you read, because you've got two natures inside of you, Christian. You've got the old nature, the sinful nature. You've got the new nature in Christ, and you're going to face temptations in life, and whichever nature you have fed and exercised, that's going to be the nature that is victorious. And if you're constantly feeding the flesh in the moment of greatest temptation, you're going to give in to that. But if you're constantly feeding the Spirit, you're going to have the strength that you need. Be careful with idle thoughts. Psalm 101, verse 3 says, I will not look with approval on anything that is vile. Avoid emotional attachments. You know, that's how it often starts. It's not, first of all, an immediate physical attraction. It comes to that. But initially, it's an emotional attraction. Because he notices you, and he always has a compliment. Your husband, he didn't notice your new hairstyle, but he did. Your husband didn't notice the new dress, but he did. Your husband's always busy, but he always has time to hear about your life. And you become attracted to that. And before long, that emotional attachment becomes a physical attraction, and sin is committed. Avoid it. Get off the island. Run from it. But you got to do more than that. It's not just a negative thing. And I can just hear somebody, maybe somebody watching. You Baptist preachers, all you talk about is sexual temptation. Like, that's the worst thing in the world. Well, I just read you a whole chapter in the Bible, in the middle of the Bible, that deals with that. I didn't make this stuff up. It's in Scripture, and it's serious business. But I don't want to be totally negative about it, because we're going to struggle with this. I want to give you some positive things to do, some positive actions to take. Number one, work on your self-image. How do you see yourself? The devil will tell you, you're just an animal, so live like one. You want it, go for it. But you're more than an animal. You're a special, unique creation of God. Unique. His image is stamped on you. So develop a good self-image. When Joseph, not Mary and Joseph and Jesus in the New Testament, but Joseph in the Old Testament, when he was about 17 years old, he was a slave. He was working for a guy, and the guy was never home. His wife, older, took a keen interest in Joseph because Joseph was young and handsome and all that stuff. So she is attracted to him, and she keeps saying things to him whenever he's around, seductively whispering, dripping honey, as the writer of Proverbs would say. But he won't listen to her, and he keeps rebuffing her. But one day she grabs him, and the scripture says he ran, left his coat right in her arms. He ran for his life. He was fleeing fornication because he wasn't afraid of her. He was afraid of what he might do. So he ran. But in this matter of self-esteem, that same story, before he runs, he makes a little speech. And I think it's one of the greatest speeches in the Bible. She's trying to get him to go ahead, and she's saying, I'm sure she's saying, well, nobody will know, and I won't tell my husband, and we can just have a good time and then go on with our lives. And you're a long way from home, and who is God anyway? I'm sure she said all that sort of stuff. And here's his speech. He said, I cannot do this. I cannot do this great wickedness and sin against God. No one, here's the part I like, no one in this house is greater than I am. The master has given everything under my control except you. No one is greater than I am. Now that's healthy self-image. He knew who he was. Do you know who you are? A child of God. Now you've got all this energy and this sexual desire, and God made you that way. Try this. Channel it all in the direction of your mate. Pour your romance there. And the writer says that. Drink water from your own cistern. Rejoice in the wife of your youth. Be ever intoxicated with her love. So pour out your love to her. If you want to write a poem, write it to her. If you want to plan a weekend getaway, plan it with him. Pour all of your attention. Start noticing things. You can talk your way back into a healthier relationship by noticing and complimenting, flirting and loving. Pay attention to your own marriage. And with everybody else that you work with, and we work together all the time, Paul the Apostle said in 1 Timothy 5:1, treat younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters with all purity. She's not a sex object there for you. She's your sister in Christ. He's your brother in the Lord. Treat each other as family. And this is so important. Consider your body a temple of the Holy Spirit, a sacred space. Paul says that in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Don't you know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which you have of God, that you are not your own? You were bought with a price, and yes, you were. Jesus died for you. He went to the cross for your sins. And now that he's forgiven your sins, he wants to live in you and make your body a temple. There was a philosophy in Paul's day, it's not a Christian philosophy, but it was rampant, that you were a soul inhabiting a body. And the only thing that mattered was your soul. Your body, well, you could do anything you wanted to with that. No, Paul is very clear here. You have a soul, you are a body, and all of it belongs to God. There are two words for temple in the old Greek language. One word described the whole temple complex in Jerusalem. It's a very general word. But then there was another word that spoke of the holy place. And if you know anything about the tabernacle or the construction of the temple, the holy place. And then inside of there, the most holy place. And that's where the high priest would go once a year to offer sacrifices. And there was a thick curtain that kept everybody else out. It was believed that that's where God came to meet with his people. And here Paul says, your body is that place. He wants to live inside of you. You were bought with a price. You're not cheap. So don't act cheap. Act like who you are. And then one more line from Proverbs 5, and we're finished. Proverbs 5, verse chapter 5, verse 21. Your ways are in full view of the Lord. Your ways are in full view of the Lord. I remember today that when my parents dropped me off on Franklin Street in Richmond for my first weekend at Virginia Commonwealth University, I was so naive, you know. I was teaching little old ladies about sexual temptation, but beyond that, I was pretty naive about the ways of the world. And my parents were dropping me off. They'd done the best they could. They'd raised me in church, had me there every time the door was open. Got me involved in everything, even when I didn't want to be. Sometimes they'd done their job, they dropped me off. They said something like that. Your ways, remember, your ways are in full view of the Lord. He's watching. Here's a reality TV show for you, probably the oldest one. Did you ever watch Candid Camera? It started in the 1940s, and every decade for 8 decades, it was on television. And they would have a hidden camera, and they would play a practical joke on somebody or put you in an awkward situation and see what you would do. And finally, you'd be flustered, and the announcer, Alan Funt, would say, "Smile, you're on Candid Camera." Well, now we all are, aren't we? Because everybody's got a phone and every business establishment has a camera. People are watching. Now that ought to frighten you a little bit. What also should give you pause is that God is watching. And our lives are accountable to him. For every day we live, he wants us to lead lives of purity that glorify him. I pray that is true for you. Would you pray with me, please? When the service is over in just a few moments, I'll linger behind. And if there's anybody that wants to talk about this or talk about a commitment to Jesus, or you saw Kate get baptized today and you'd like to do that, just come and tell me. We'll sit down and talk about it. We can make that happen. It'd be my privilege to talk to you today. Father, bless your word to our hearing. Direct our paths, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand and let's sing together as we...
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more.
Church of Alexandria. This is Liz Wang, the Community Development Director of Casa Chilawa.
Hello, this is Tammy Mann from the Campaña Center.
We, as the Evangelical Relief Agency.
My name is Penny Harrison, and I am the very proud principal of Douglas MacArthur Elementary School here in Alexandria.
Eden Buba here at T.C. Williams High School.
Greetings from Lebanon. On behalf of the Lebanese Society for Educational and Social Development,
I'm Paul Chitwood, President of the International Mission Board.
I am recording from our food pantry. We at Casa Chilawa want to thank you for helping us to assist the people that are in most need. In 2020, we were able to provide with 2,240 grocery food bags and 1,414 fresh produce boxes. And also, we were able to provide $170,000 in financial assistance.
Words of thanks to First Baptist Church for the incredible support they provided as we hosted a community-wide emergency diaper bank during the pandemic. The church willingly made its entire parking lot available to us for distributions that happened every month from May through December 2020.
I'm very thankful for the First Baptist Church of Alexandria and for very important humanitarian aid for the refugees in Bosnia.
Thank you for your leadership, your care, and support, and the full heart that you have given us through this very difficult and trying time.
I just want to give a sincere thank you from Young Life for being our ministry partners, for helping us to recruit leaders and committee members, and also opening your doors so we have a safe space to meet and reach the youth in our city.
For coming alongside us as we address the basic needs of vulnerable Lebanese families as well as Syrian refugees in Lebanon.
Thank you, First Baptist Church of Alexandria, for helping ensure that Southern Baptists for 175 years have sent missionaries and had a witness among the nations without interruption.
Thank you for your love and partnership in our common service to people in need, be it earthquake survivors or migrants that no one wants to see.
The church also provided donations of diapers to us. The funding and the donation of diapers made it possible for the Campaña Center to provide these much needed supplies to families in our community. Each month we provided on average 40,000 diapers that helped to make sure children had their needs met during this time of crisis.
We address the basic needs of vulnerable Lebanese families as well as Syrian refugees in Lebanon, providing them with much needed food vouchers, winterization items to keep them warm this winter, as well as hygiene kits to protect them against COVID-19. Thank you as well for partnering with us as we provide psychosocial support for Syrian refugee children in Lebanon.
I wish that God will bless you abundantly and repay you for all the goodness you have shown to these people in need.
Thank you for being a beacon of positivity and purpose in a time where so many things are uncertain. You have shown up and stepped up for our community and our students, and we are forever grateful.
We are so grateful for each one of you that has supported us spiritually, emotionally, and financially. We bless you, and as God continues blessing your family with provision and abundance.
And we can't thank you enough.
May God bless you richly.
We're so grateful for you guys. Thank you, First Baptist Church of Alexandria.
Whether you are home or in the building, I hope coming to church today was spiritually uplifting and that you felt connected to God and to others in the FBCA community. One of the biggest outreach events that help us connect to our community every year is Vacation Bible School, and we are thrilled to be able to offer it both online and in person this year. Registration is open. And don't forget, in order to be able to host and serve our community, we need lots of adults and youth to volunteer. The more of you that volunteer, the more kids we can share Jesus with. So register now, either to attend or to help. Things are getting busier and busier for our students, but we hope you'll make time to come to youth worship today. It can be easy to forget who God really is. It can be even easier for us to forget who we really are. Jesus' death and resurrection shows us we're loved, important, forgiven, and more to Him. In this series, Afterlife, You'll be reminded what is true about yourselves because of the gift we celebrate at Easter, Jesus' resurrection and afterlife. After youth worship wraps up, you can head on over to youth choir. We're preparing for the upcoming mission trip, July 25th through 29th. It's one of the youth's favorite events. You should come. This is one great way to form close relationships with others in the youth group and give back to underserved communities at the same time. Even if you can't go on the mission trip, we still want you to join the youth choir. Just make sure to check the registration page for COVID safety information and then register so we know to expect you. One final event, and this one is for the adults. Pastor Carolyn wants you to join her at Green Spring Gardens for a tour and then have lunch outside at Chewy's. All adults are welcome. I mean, who doesn't like Mexican food? And I want to give you one tip about ordering at Chewy's. They have an off-menu item that you can order called Shirley Goo for all you chicken queso and rice lovers. So register by tomorrow to attend both or just one part of the event. This is a great way to get out and to get to know new people if you're new at FBCA. And now may you go in the grace and peace of Jesus as you seek to honor Him.